Welcome to the broadcast tonight. Peter Maass, former foreign correspondent of the Washington Post, on atrocities in war.
When this man, for example, told me this story of witnessing one prisoner being forced to castrate another prisoner, I looked at him after he told me this story and I said, I don't believe you. There's a point beyond which human beings do not go. And he looked at me and he said, if I hadn't seen it myself, I would not believe it either.
Kathleen Quinlan of Apollo 13, the movie.
Some people say they're going to become an actor.
Yeah.
And I always think you can't become one. You almost have to be cursed to be one. You know, you either are or you aren't in a certain way. There's a lot of people that have learned tools that they can do it, but I think that an actor is by nature. That's what they are, like a painter is a painter, and a poet is a poet.
And Michael Tilson Thomas, the conductor.
My great belief in music is that it is most important when you are not hearing it.
Meaning?
Meaning that as you hear a piece of music, as you grow to know and love a piece of music, as you are touched by a performance in the same way that you would be touched by someone's hand, it's something that you remember. It leaves a mark upon you.
Peter Maass, Kathleen Quinlan, and Michael Tilson Thomas, when we continue.
Charlie Rose is made possible by a grant from USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
As the presidential elections approach in Bosnia, peace remains tentative in the war-ravaged land of the former Yugoslavia. In Love Thy Neighbor, a story of war, Peter Maass recounts the horrors and atrocities he witnessed as a foreign correspondent for the Washington Post in 1992 and 1993. While condemning the guilty parties, he also confronts what he calls, quote, the wild beast that lives within us all. I'm pleased to have him here as part of our own continuing coverage of what is happening in Bosnia and to have him tell what is an incredible story. Welcome.
Good to be here.
To have you here. Tell me how you approached this. You went to Bosnia. Was it an assignment you coveted that you very much wanted? How did you end up there?
It was an assignment that fell into my lap. I was based in Budapest, Hungary, right next door to Yugoslavia. And the war broke out. And the way these things are covered by the Washington Post is basically on a territorial basis. Because it was near to myself and my two colleagues who were in Warsaw, because it was such a big war that there was more to do than just for one person, all three of us were shuttling in and out of there all the time, spending most of our time in Bosnia, Serbia, and Croatia, covering the war. None of us had covered a war before. I, in fact, had never been to Bosnia before. You learn quite quickly when you're covering a war, so I think all of us. It got this kind of rapid-fire, fast-forward type of history lesson, political lesson, and went up to speed very quickly.
And you came away with what sense of the causes and the events that led to what we have today? Give me your fix on that.
My fix on it is that it was very manipulated from above, that this was not a kind of nationalism and a desire on the part of the people there to just kill each other into extinction as a part of tribal rivalries.
An eruption of repressed tribal...
There was certainly an eruption, okay, but it was an eruption that was fueled from the outside and from above through the media. I remember this one time when I was in Banja Luka talking with this Serb woman about her village, what happened in her village. There were Muslims there, and she said they were all rounded up at the very beginning of the conflict. And I said, oh, were they planning some kind of revolt? And she said, no, but what they were planning to do was to kind of take control slowly and then put all of the Serb women into harems for each Muslim man. And I thought this was kind of ludicrous. And I asked her, well, how did you know this? She said it was on the radio, Serb radio. And I said, you believed it? And she said, yes, why would the radio lie? And then I said to her, well, had the Muslims in your village ever done anything bad to you before? And she said, well, no, we all got along quite well. And I found this throughout former Yugoslavia, that yes, there were rivalries, as there are in every society. What made this conflict happen was not the existence of the rivalries, but the fact that they were fueled, and they were fueled...
The propaganda that fueled it and stirred it up.
Absolutely. Absolutely. The kinds of things that were on television Serb television that people were exposed to were of a almost hysterical level in terms of the types of things that were being said about the Muslims of Bosnia, that they were jihad warriors, that they wanted to, you know, put all the Christian women into harems, etc., things of that sort. These things were absolutely, really, unthinkable to a rational person. But the thing is, what I found there is that when you put a little bit of fear into somebody's mind, which is what this propaganda did, and then you provide them with weapons, which is what Milosevic did, and then you give them perhaps some incentive, saying it's a patriotic act to use these weapons against your Muslim or your Croat neighbors, it is surprising what people will do. And it's not because, in the case of Bosnia, these people were of a less civilized nature than ourselves. I mean, in 1984, the Winter Olympics were held in Sarajevo. Bosnia, Yugoslavia seemed very stable, as stable to those people then as America does to us now.
So, but surely you're not saying that what happened there and the reason we saw such genocide and such atrocities and such ethnic cleansing is simply because people became stirred up by the Crusades and the grab for power by their leadership, and they did unthinkable things that they would never have considered doing unless they'd been stirred up?
I think that's largely the case. I mean, certainly there were people at the top. Slobodan Milosevic, the president of Serbia, the leaders of this process in Bosnia amongst the Serbs, who were very thoughtful about this and wanted to push this process of nationalism towards war forward. But in terms of the vast majority of people, I found them to be relatively happy with the way things were before the war, but then all of a sudden, because of the propaganda, because of the fear that was instilled within them, and the polarization that happened once these crimes began to be committed, they almost had no choice. There was this one kid I ran into in Banja Luka. I wrote about him in the book, because he was so memorable, 18-year-old kid. And I asked him, what do you think of the war? And he said, the war is stupid. We're being fooled by our leaders. And I said to him, okay, you're 18 years old. You're going to be drafted perhaps tomorrow. What are you going to do? And he said, well, I'm going to go into the army. What else do I do? If I don't do that, I'll go into jail. And this, to me, was the choice that so many people were faced with. They didn't really do these acts, the vast majority of people, with such, you know, energy and such violence. I mean, there were these snipers that I visited above Sarajevo. Again, ordinary guys, okay? And one of them had a friend in London. I was with two British colleagues. And he said to my colleagues, can you please pass on this message to my friend in London? Fine. So he gave us the message, and then we left. And because we're journalists, we looked at it. And there was this one line in it that was, I can't forget it, it was amazing. He said to his friend in this message, I'm stationed on the front line. I have become as stupid as an empty bottle of rum. And he knew this was madness. He was participating in it.
I have become as stupid. So not born psychopaths, but people who became something that they couldn't imagine themselves becoming.
This guy, for example, who said he had become as stupid as an empty bottle of rum, his parents were still in Sarajevo. He was manning a heavy machine gun that was pointed right down at Sarajevo. He was firing at Sarajevo. The bullets that he fired could very well have killed, or would kill, his own parents.
I want to come back to all the atrocities that you saw and the people you talked to, and I mean things that had to have an impact on you, in just a second. Let me fast forward ahead. Give me your appraisal of what you think is going to happen. Will the peace, Dayton Peace Accord, prove to be wise, and will it maintain the peace, or is it a situation in which all sides are simply waiting for the Americans and the peacekeepers to pull out before hostilities resume?
The right question to ask, but an impossible one to answer. I mean, I guess I could answer it, and lots of people have, but most of the predictions that have been made in the past by knowledgeable people and by not knowledgeable people have turned out to be wrong. The one thing about these events that they have shown to me in general about human beings is just how creative humans are and how destructive they are and how unpredictable they are. In the matter of war and peace, I've kind of gotten out of the business of predictions.
Describe some of the people. I mean, what do you think has to happen in order for it not to resume with the intensity it had before Dayton?
People have to be able to go home. That really is it. If the Muslim who is a refugee now in Sarajevo can go back to his or her home in Banja Luka, or go back to his or her home in Zvornik or Srebrenica,
The Serbs occupy Banja Luka and the Muslims occupy
Srebrenica. That is absolutely key. Because if you don't have that, it's going to be a Gaza-type situation where these people are all refugees in this very small area of territory that is economically, you know, inoperable in the sense of not being able to survive very well, which is, of course, just a recipe for continued turmoil.
Let me talk about some of the main characters, too. You mentioned Milosevic. You saw him for, what, 90 minutes? How long?
Yeah, it was fascinating. I interviewed him for 90 minutes in his office. It was a fascinating time because, I mean, I think Milosevic is an evil genius and the kind of evil genius that only comes along every so often.
Now, what's interesting about this is Richard Holbrooke and others have been on this program suggesting that the peace accord would never have happened in Dayton without him, that in the end he was pushing more for it than even the Muslims who had some real problems with it.
The
Bosnian government.
The thing about Milosevic is that he is an opportunist. Whatever is good for him to keep himself in power, he will do.
So it's not about greater Serbia, it's about power for Milosevic.
It's about greater Milosevic. And that's always been the case, and I think pretty much everybody realizes that now and accepts that as the case. I mean, you know, he agreed to see me. He rarely gave interviews, but he wanted to get a point across to the Clinton administration, so he agreed to an interview with the Washington
Post. Paper.
Exactly, with the hometown paper. And he was utterly charming. When I went into his office, it's a very nice office, very calm and potted plants and things of that sort. There were just two of us, myself and Milosevic, in the office. There was not a note taker, there was not foreign minister, interpreter, anything like that.
You spoke in what language?
English. He speaks very good English because he worked in New York for a while.
That's right, he likes 48th Street or something.
Exactly,
like
and we talked, for example, we chatted, he'd been to Los Angeles, I'm from LA, and so we chatted about Los Angeles. He said, oh yes, you know, I've been to Los Angeles, it's a really big town, it's, you know, a bit too sprawling for me, he said. He's very charming, offered me, you know, a cigarillo and orange juice and coffee and whatever, and gave me all the time really I wanted. And he sat there, and when I asked him questions about the cleansing of Bosnia, etc., he looked at me with the most sincere of eyes and lied utterly and absolutely.
Time after time.
To the extent, fortunately, I'd been in Bosnia, and I knew what was going on. But if you hadn't been to Bosnia, if you didn't really know, this man could con you. And he conned a lot of people.
Mladic, the general.
I think everybody kind of realizes now he's a psychopath.
He is a psychopath.
At the beginning of the war...
With a tortured family history.
Exactly. Well, during the war, one thing that pushed him over the edge somewhat, most people agree now, is that his daughter, his favorite daughter, committed suicide. And after that, things really got out of hand in terms of the campaign that he waged. But
he lost all restraint.
Yeah. I mean, he never had much restraint, but he really then went all the way, as far as he could. And in the end, he went too far. He found out, to his surprise, I think to many other people's surprise, that indeed there was a limit to what the Western leaders, Bill Clinton and the presidents of President of France, Prime Minister of Britain, would actually stand by and let happen. He went too far.
Karadzic.
He is charming. He's also a psychopath. But
former
this
psychiatrist.
Former psychiatrist. He was a psychiatrist of the Sarajevo soccer team and tried to use hypnotism to bring them out of a slump. If you're not fighting a war against Karadzic, he's actually quite enjoyable to be around. I spent some time with him, you know, interviews and whatnot. And he tells jokes about himself, about other people, he laughs, he's charming, etc. But again, somewhat of a psychopath, certainly a pathological liar. And a man, along with Mladic, and along with Milosevic, as well as Tuđman, the president of Croatia, who probably deserves to be in jail.
All of them, criminals.
The thing is that a tribunal should be the one to decide. Let's not make our own decisions.
Okay,
let's just weigh the
probably
evidence.
Probably should be in jail, is your words.
Yeah.
What about the likelihood they will be tried first?
It all depends really on whether Bill Clinton wants to make an effort to get them. Karadzic and Mladic are in Bosnia. In Bosnia there are 20,000 American troops and there are scores of thousands of other international troops. If we want to make a stab at getting those guys, we can make a stab. It'll be somewhat risky. But I remember this one time when I was in Zagreb talking with this senior American diplomat who, like many other diplomats there at the time when the war was going on, was absolutely furious about the fact that all these things were happening, genocide against Muslims. And America and its allies were standing aside. And he said to me, this diplomat, he said, what are we paying $200 billion a year for with our army? If we have an army, a military, that's not willing to take casualties, they're Boy Scouts.
Would Milosevic give up Mladic and Karadzic?
Milosevic will give up everything except for his wife, who he is very, very close to. Everything except for his wife, he will give up.
All right, let me now talk about the toughest part of this. You talked to a man who had been forced to bite off.
Witnessed.
Witnessed. The one man being forced to bite off the testicles of another man. Just tell me about the stories you heard and what you came to understand about that kind of evil.
This man who you're speaking of, his name is Ibrahim, and I talked to him in Karlovac, a refugee camp where he was at after having been in Omarska, the worst sort of prison camp, for about 70 days. It was wintertime, I remember this so well. We were in this cold little room and it was dirty, and my hand was freezing up because it was so cold I could barely write. And I'd been interviewing survivors of prison camps for several hours, and after you hear these tales, you become somewhat weary of them just because it's so much. And he told me this story.
Does it ever become numbing as you listen to them?
It's not that it becomes numbing, it's just that it becomes almost unbearable, because you hear these things over and over and over, and you just need to say, and indeed, I did kind of say, stop, I can't hear anymore. And so when this man, for example, told me this story of witnessing one prisoner being forced to castrate another prisoner, I looked at him after he told me this story and I said, I don't believe you. There's a point beyond which human beings do not go. And he looked at me and he said, if I hadn't seen it myself, I would not believe it either. And this was the way it was in Bosnia. I listened to all these things. Other journalists listened to all these things. And at first, we just could not believe it. Who would have believed that in Europe at the end of the 20th century, there would be prison camps where you get these people walking around who were walking skeletons? I visited the prison camps before they were closed down. And I saw men walking there, and I talked with men who really had no flesh on their arms. And I looked at their arms, and I realized that these were just fragile sticks, practically, that could be snapped. This is Europe at the end of the 20th century. If I had not seen that, I would not have believed it. And that's what I've tried to write about, so that people understand that it did happen, that it was there, and what it was like to be there.
And what does it say about all of us?
There's this wild beast within us. It's the dark side. What happened in Bosnia was not a Balkan freak show where people of a lesser nature went mad. Yes, they went mad, but not because they're a lesser nature than us. It's because they're humans, and humans are flawed. We have this dark side. And under the right circumstances, it comes out. And these mad, mad things happen. And the more we know about what happened there, why, what it is, the more we know about ourselves, and the more we can defend ourselves from becoming victims of the same kind of madness.
How do you defend yourself from being victims of the same madness if you're pushed to the same circumstances?
It's really tough, because you want to say, well, if something like that happens, I will stand up, I will shout, I will not stand for it. There's this one time when I was trying to find, with two colleagues, a Serb prison camp that was not disclosed at the time, and we were stopped at a roadblock. We went back to the roadblock, went down a dirt road, and were stopped by those same guys who arrested us. And they took us to a cafe to call their commander to find out what to do with us. And at the cafe, the commander of this little detachment, a Serb, saw this Muslim. Started beating him up, took a beer bottle, hit him over the head, the Muslim, blood was coming down, the Muslim was on the ground, the Serb was punching him, and then the Serb took his AK-47, pulled off the safety latch. Execution was seconds away. I was standing there with two colleagues. We watched. We could have shouted, we could have intervened, but we're journalists, we're not supposed to get involved. And even if we kind of put that rule aside, we realized that if we did get involved, we would just end up like this Muslim.
We'd be next.
Fortunately, this Muslim's wife appeared out of nowhere and threw herself between the Serb and the Muslim. And the Serb said, okay, you can go. I'm glad I didn't intervene. It turned out okay, but it gave me an insight into what it might have been like to be a Serb, to see your neighbor taken away.
You, in a sense, are saying that I probably recognized that was an instinct in me not to intervene in the interest of my own safety.
Self-preservation. I mean, I had the additional excuse, which is comfortable to have, that I'm a journalist and I shouldn't get involved. But I have to be honest, there was definitely an element of self-preservation involved there, as there was with so many people. So many people that I remember talking to this opposition leader in Banja Luka, one of the few Serbs who visibly, vocally protested and who daily faced death threats. I mean, people would walk by him on the street and go like this. They'd send him letters, and I don't know where he is now. He might have been killed. And he said to me, look, 10% of the people have guns and they have the television towers. And that's really all they need. Most of the people just follow because they're scared or they don't know what's happening. Human beings are incredibly easy, unfortunately, to manipulate. And in Bosnia, they were manipulated. And how do we stop it? It's just be as decent as you can, be as strong as you can, and try to keep these troublemakers out of power.
Could you sleep? I mean, what did it do to you seeing all this?
Yeah, I could sleep, but you can't control your dreams. There was this one time when I was in Zagreb, and there I had this good friend who worked for the BBC and who had been through a lot more than I had been. And we spent one evening, we were eating and then drinking, and then went upstairs to our rooms. We were on the same floor, and he stopped at his door before mine. And he said, "Peter, do you ever dream about Bosnia?" And I looked at him, I said, "Yeah, every night." And he looked at me, he said, "Yeah, so do I."
How did the experience in Bosnia, for you as a Jew, and understanding the Holocaust, how did it cause you to deepen your perceptions and understandings of the Holocaust?
I like to think that, or I would like to think that, that my reactions, my anger at what happened, the evil, and my anger at the fact that good men outside of Bosnia did not stand up to this evil, is due not to the fact that I'm Jewish, but just because I'm, I'd like to think, a decent human being with reactions of anger that come when it's justified. But I have spent more time, I suppose, than, you know, many people who are not Jewish, thinking about the Holocaust, reading about the Holocaust. My family was in Germany before the war, and they were all forced out. And it's a question that is of such, you know, major importance. How do these things happen? Why is it that people execute such orders, you know, to carry out a Holocaust or stand by while such orders are being executed? And I suppose that what that did with me in Bosnia was it made me explore these questions to a greater depth than maybe otherwise would have been the case. And I've tried to put all that into my book, what these questions were, these universal questions.
Which are?
Why?
Why?
Why does this happen? Why
do
men
do
it?
Why do this to themselves?
Why do they stand aside?
Why do they stand aside?
And is it something special about Germans, or is it something special about Bosnians? Why? It's not.
And could it happen again?
It's going to happen again. It's been happening every century in human existence, virtually. And the fact that it's happening now at the end of 20th century with CNN broadcasting from Sarajevo, I was in Banja Luka with a Muslim leader there, and he said, "Look, on the days when we have electricity, we've got satellite dishes on our roofs. We can watch this genocide being committed against us, as everybody else around the world also watched. If it happened in Bosnia as it really did, and in 1991, 2, 3, 4, 5, I would have a hard time imagining why.
So you say in the end, and I've got to go out, you say in the end, you cannot see this without asking how could one person inflict so much pain and suffering without debasing themselves, and how could they live with themselves, and how does another person who may be there and a witness to this or have some power to do something stand by and allow it to happen, whether it's a nation, whether it's Washington, whether it's a reporter covering it, whether it's a neighbor, whether it's another soldier. How could we allow this to happen? At the same time, you look at what happened in World War II, in Asia, mm-hmm. in Germany, mm-hmm. and you say, it's all happened worse. And it will happen again. And it's happened in Cambodia, and it's happened in Africa, and it's happened in every corner of the world.
We have wonderful things.
And it is something about the capacity of man's inhumanity to man in order to save himself.
The capacity to hate, the capacity to love. It's there, always.
The book is Love Thy Neighbor, A Story of War by Peter Maass. He is a 12-year foreign correspondent for the Washington Post, now covering the Metropolitan Beat for the Washington Post.
When we come back, Kathleen Quinlan, later Michael Tilson Thomas.
Stay with us. All of the women nominated for Best Supporting Actress for this year's Academy Awards are first-time nominees. But one actress in particular has been around. Kathleen Quinlan made her acting debut in George Lucas's film American Graffiti. It launched several careers, including that of Ron Howard. 20 years later, the two were reunited for Howard's Apollo 13, the story of the ill-fated NASA mission. Quinlan has been praised for providing the heart of the film with her fearless portrayal of Marilyn Lovell, the wife of the imperiled mission commander. And we're pleased to have her here on this program this evening. Welcome.
Welcome. Thank you. Thank you very much.
You spent some time with the Lovell family and even got to fly his plane.
That is right.
Yeah. Tell me about that, the sense of knowing someone like Marilyn and knowing at the same time that Ron Howard knew that this character, in a sense, was to be the reality base for the people watching the film.
Well, it's interesting because I didn't know that that's what Ron had in mind.
Yeah.
And after spending 3 days and three nights with the Lovells in their home, which was a privilege in itself, I started to develop that idea myself.
Yeah.
And when I brought the notes that I had to Ron, then we started to flesh out the character a lot more, and that's how it wound up. But I don't think either one of us actually ever said that to each other during the entire filming.
That she would be a kind of base that people could relate to because that she would reflect.
Right. She would be an emotional sort of anchor, a base where people could check in and sort of see emotionally what it meant on a personal basis.
And what were in those notes you brought back from that 3 days?
What were in those notes? The NASA women were an invisible part of the team. They were thought of that way by the people who ran NASA themselves. They put their blood, sweat, and tears into every mission and made sure that the home front had a certain amount of homeostasis from which they could launch. They were single parents because their men were either they were either doing test piloting or they were off, you know, to the moon. They had to be able to not only, well, Marilyn especially, had to not only be able to parlay with the kings and queens or the presidents and the president's wives, or they had to be able to make lunch for three children and take the trash out. You know, they had to be able to jump between both worlds.
When you, after meeting her, did it change your impression at all?
Completely. If I had not have met Marilyn, it would have been a totally different performance, probably a lot drier, probably. I had to see who she was, and she shared a lot of memorabilia with me, but one of the things that she shared with me that really hit home was they were asked at that time, not in the present, not to share their feelings with their husbands, their best friends, what their fears or trepidations were, to kind of keep it to themselves. And so even if she was feeling this whole thing about the mission, which she did, that she didn't like it or how it was going, how the training sessions were being pushed, she had to keep it to herself. So that became an interesting dichotomy to play and to be able to reveal it just enough that the audience knew what was going on.
I mean, it's the worst possible therapeutic advice they could give anybody is keep all your feelings inside.
Absolutely.
And don't reveal them and stifle your emotions and all
Absolutely.
Of that.
Absolutely.
How about Lovell? Jim Lovell has been a guest on this program, as have Ron Howard and others, Ed Harris. Lovell is a fascinating guy. I mean,
yes.
You have a sense of a genuine American hero, the way he performed under challenge.
I felt like I was going to meet an icon, you know, I was going to meet a myth. And then, of course, you know, when you meet him, he's such a person.
Yeah.
And Jim and Marilyn flew me in there, in his Beechcraft plane, I hope I got that right, to Houston to go to the NASA Space Museum. And I could not get over the fact that here I was with one of the pioneers of the universe, and he was flying me to the NASA Space Museum. And Marilyn was in the back graciously serving us coffee out of a thermos. But hearing everything firsthand, and I never intruded upon his story so much. I was more there for Marilyn. But I did ask him one question, which was, how did you, when that many things go against you, why was it that you just could keep going like that? And he said, I never felt like I didn't have a card to play.
Yeah.
And that, to me, is an extraordinary human being.
There was always hope. He had something else he could do.
Yes.
Right. Take a look at this. This is a clip from Apollo 13, Academy Award nominee.
I have a request from the news people.
Uh-huh.
They're out front here, and they want to put a transmitter up on the lawn.
Transmitter?
It's kind of a tower for live broadcasts.
I thought they didn't care about this mission. They didn't even run Jim's show.
Well, it's more dramatic now. Suddenly people are...
Oh, if landing on the moon wasn't dramatic enough for them, why should not landing on it be?
Look, I realize how hard this is, Marilyn, but the whole world is caught up in it. It's the
no,
story
Henry.
Since...
Those people don't put one piece of equipment on my lawn. If they have a problem with that, they can take it up with my husband. He'll be home on Friday.
Were you surprised at the nomination?
Yes.
Were you really? I mean...
Well, I was. I was...
It was talked about before it came down, obviously.
It was talked about. And during Rose Garden, it was talked about. So I learned early on never to believe any of that until it comes about. And so I think it's really starting to hit home about now. Because I've been working outside of the country, and I haven't been there for all the...
What film have you been working on?
Zeus and Roxanne. It's a family film.
Directed by?
Directed by George Miller, who did Man from Snowy River, and it's with Steve Guttenberg, A Dog and a Dolphin.
A Dog and a Dolphin is Steve Guttenberg.
Yes.
Take me back to American Graffiti, because as I remember the story, George Lucas came to your high school.
Yes.
And you had no intention of going into acting at all.
No, I played with it.
Yeah.
But I was really a jock at that point.
A gymnast and other
gymnast
things.
And a diver.
You still are a jock.
Yes, I'm afraid so. But I went to a cattle call. I was called out of a cattle call, what they called then. Now they call it atmosphere.
Yeah,
yes.
Right.
And I was asked by Fred Roos to come in and read a small part for George Lucas, who was then in, had Zoetrope, and they were in San Francisco.
Right.
And then I went and I did it, and Ron was this big movie star. I was going to the high school they shot at, so.
And then you got the role.
I got the role.
And you come up behind, is it Ron? Who do you come up behind and you say?
Ron.
What do you say?
I think I said, Joe College strikes out.
Yeah.
So it was great fun, but I never thought that it would continue after that.
Yeah, but you decided that's what you wanted to do?
Well, to tell you the truth, in my naivete in those days, I didn't see how I could make a living as a gym teacher, or as a gymnast, anyway, or as a diver. I didn't really understand, you know, other than I was going to teach basic gymnastics. And somebody offered me, said, would you like to come? Jimmy Hyde said, would you like to come to Los Angeles and try your hand at it? And I thought, sure, I'll give it a shot.
And what was next?
Started to see what could be done with it and what I could actually give to it, and then it became more interesting.
What's the best advice you've gotten about acting?
Advice that I've gotten about acting?
Or who have you worked with that's influenced you, that's helped you?
You know, almost every job I meet somebody that
makes a difference,
gives me something. Now Ron was really something, because I thought he has his eyes on so many things in this huge production. Every little detail he had his eye on. He's not going to see these little moments that I'm doing. And he saw every one of them, and he knew just what to delete and just what to pull up. So he was somebody that I really learned something from. And the only, I mean, there's lots of incredible actors and actresses, especially now. But I remember watching Louise Rainier in The Good Earth and going, she's translucent. She just is that person. You can see, and she was so ahead of her time in terms of style, I thought.
Yeah. I never promised you a rose garden. What did that do for you? How important was that for you?
Well, it was very important in terms of really being challenged on every level as to what I could do. And I didn't have many tools then. I just had more instinct. It left me a little raw at the end. But I suppose I got quite spoiled in a way, because it was such a challenge at such a young age, and material like that doesn't come all the time.
I imagine instincts are the best thing you can have because you can develop the tools. I don't know whether you can develop the instincts or not. I mean, those seem to be more of a natural quality.
I agree with you. I agree. I think, you know, some people say they're going to become an actor.
Yeah.
And I always think you can't become one. You almost have to be cursed to be one. You know, you either are or you aren't in a certain way. There's a lot of people that have learned tools that they can do it, but I think that an actor is by nature, that's what they are, like a painter is a painter, and a poet is a poet.
Any ambition to direct, to make the kind of transition that Ron Howard made?
Secretly.
Yeah.
But way later down the line, I have a son and I don't want to give up that kind of time right now. Yeah, I think that if you're a director, you have to be at it from its inception all the way till its delivery. And I don't believe they get much time at home. And I enjoy my time at home right now.
You seem to be so, I mean, what is it acting brings to you? What's the thing that you enjoy the most about
acting?
Not about being an actor, but about acting.
Yes, no kidding, not about being an actor, but about what you can give, what I can give. What I can give at certain times. I can't always do it. It depends on what the role is and what the director's perception of the piece is. But I think sometimes, if you're lucky, you can give certain insights to certain kinds of people and what they go through.
And what's the hardest thing to learn about it?
About acting itself?
About acting.
I still have a lot to learn.
Yeah, I know, but you're a... And you hope that it'll continue that way until
yes.
you stop acting.
Right. The hardest thing to learn? The hardest thing, one of the things that I learned, I think, from one director named Peter Wood, who is a stage director, was to bring feelings to a point, but then to hold them there, not to indulge in feeling it all the way myself, but to allow the audience to take it from there. And
so you bring it up to a certain level, and
hopefully,
then the audience reaches
and
in.
And I want the people to feel it, not just me.
Is stage better than film?
It's different.
Just different?
Different.
Not better, not worse.
Not better. They're totally different animals.
Yeah.
I think it's a lot harder in certain ways because you have to have it orchestrate performance, and you do it from the beginning to the end, and you have to have a different stamina. But on the other hand, if you work on a film, you have to have in your mind how to orchestrate it in moments, because it's done in such a choppy manner.
When you get a nomination, does it make all the difference in the world? I mean, does everybody sort of step up and say, all of a sudden, Kathleen Quinlan, we've got to have her?
It seems to be doing that, which
yeah.
I'm happy to say. I'm enjoying the whole ride, first of all. And
the ride
it's a great ride. I've been waiting for it. It's fun. I'm at a time in my life where I can really enjoy it, and it's certainly helped in the work department. I don't expect it to last forever, and I hope to keep my focus on the work no matter what happens.
Do you find that more and more there more is as you grow and evolve as an actress, you know, that the number of roles that are there with increasing attention to you and respect for your craft, do the roles grow, the opportunities grow? I mean, can you sit now and choose?
And choose? You know, you can choose in an odd way. I don't, for instance, have five scripts in front of me and go, I want to do that one.
Five great scripts.
Great scripts.
You would do all of them if you could.
I mean, I'm happy to read one great script and hope that the director wants to work with me as much as I want to work with him.
And was Apollo that script, that kind of script, instantly?
No.
It wasn't?
No.
You didn't read it and say, this is for me?
I read it and I went, well, I'm not really sure where you can go with this, but I wanted the opportunity to work with Ron Howard and Tom Hanks and to be a part of such a great story that was true. But I really didn't know at the time where I could go with it. And it was hard to, it was a hard marlin to land. It was not easy.
A hard marlin to land? Are you a fisherman?
No, not anymore.
Tom Hanks was shut out of the nominations.
Well, I suppose you could say that. I don't think that Tom, knowing feels Tom that. A little bit, feels that way.
Yeah.
I mean, how many times can a guy do it? He's been up there twice, and Tom's really after the work now more than anything. He's a relentless worker and always wants to grow and expand no matter how much attention he's received.
I thought that was what Apollo had. It was a number of terrific performances. I mean, and you really look, I mean, the three in the capsule to start off with.
Yes.
And you, and Ed Harris.
And Gary Sinise, and Kevin Bacon, and exactly. Bill Paxton. It just went on and on. And everybody had the equal amount of commitment, and that's an unusual thing to be a part of in a film. There was not one person there that wasn't as excited and as committed.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Pleasure to have you.
Thank you very much.
Good luck.
All right.
You'll be there.
Yes, it'll be fun.
We'll be right back. Stay with us. Michael Tilson Thomas grew up in a house filled with music and song and entertainment. His father learned piano from Gershwin, and his grandparents were founding members of the legendary Yiddish Theater in New York. After his professional debut at age 24, Tilson Thomas quickly established himself as one of the great American-born conductors and interpreters of 20th century music. Last September, after years of jet-setting to conduct some of the world's most celebrated orchestras, he became music director of the San Francisco Symphony, and at long last, we're pleased to have him at this table. Welcome.
Thank you.
It's great to have you here. There is a couple of things that I want to just, that are part of your lore, the legend of Michael Tilson Thomas. One is, and I was telling somebody your story today, and I said it's one of those great stories, and it shows you how we tend to change in our own mind stories. I said, Leonard Bernstein couldn't appear one night, and Michael Tilson Thomas came on, and his career was made. You know, and that was, and I didn't realize that it wasn't that way at all. That in fact, what happened? You did in fact come on at a very young age.
Right.
It was William
Steinberg was ill, and it was a Boston Symphony concert, and the concert was in progress, and he came off the stage and said, "Get your suit on. You're going on." 5 minutes later, I was on.
And it was a spectacular debut.
Worked well.
And Leonard Bernstein then became your great friend.
He was a great colleague and friend and someone to talk about music very seriously.
Yeah. And how did he shape your career, your life, your sense of what you would do?
Boy, that's a tough one to answer because I don't think he really did in many ways except that, as I say, he was a person whose intellect and whose instincts were both so powerfully operative at once that I could readily identify with him and discuss things with him from all sides. I mean, there are some musicians who have an instinctive approach to music, but perhaps don't have the kind of liberal arts education that he had, that I've also had, so that you can make your entry into a piece of music via a painting or via a poem or via an artistic movement or a historical happening. There are so many pathways. And of course, one aspect of his personality, which has been largely overlooked since his death, is that he was a very intense Yiddishkeit character. And almost every other sentence had some Yiddish word in it or some one-liner. I mean, he had that whole sense of his work with Betty and Adolph and everybody in his Broadway years. And so coming from my family, we had a lot of stories, a lot of territory in common.
I would think his life would make a wonderful movie.
Yeah, who's going to play him?
Well, I don't know. That's right. I've met him several times in his lifetime, and I've been in Washington, the Kennedy Center. He was always smoking. I mean, I never hardly saw him. He was smoking a lot then.
Yeah.
But he was just so electric as a presence.
Truly.
And we all saw it in his teaching. I mean, I'm interested in doing a series of television shows about great teachers. If you did it, I would assume that he would have to be on the list because he showed in television this wonderful capacity.
He was a great teacher, and of course, on television, what he showed was a relatively more superficial aspect of his teaching. What was interesting with him, and this was a great chance that I had as a young musician, was to begin studying a piece really from the very first note and step by step see how the whole process of the work could be built up. And this was a process which he engaged in almost entirely by asking you questions. Why do you think this is here? Why would this guy do this over here? And sometimes you'd say, well, I don't know why. And he'd say, I don't know why either, but let's think about
it. Yeah, exactly. Let's search together.
That's right.
Yeah. It must be wonderful to live a life in music because you can never every time you see a great piece of music and you assemble an orchestra to play it, it's going to be different, isn't it?
Well, it is different, and it's a wonderful experience to have this kind of Einführung, this kind of one growing, one becoming, which can happen amongst all the musicians of an orchestra, all their various reaction times and their past histories and their personalities and their political affiliations, whatever else. Somehow all these things, these differences are cast aside, and there is this fusion, and that's a very exciting feeling, to feel this one-mindedness which can happen in the ensemble and which you sense is the sum of all the individuals who are there. That is a wonderful thing. And perhaps still more wonderful is that after the performance is over, you feel that you have been enriched by the performance. I mean, my great belief in music is that it is most important when you are not hearing it.
Meaning?
Meaning that as you hear a piece of music, as you grow to know and love a piece of music, as you are touched by a performance in the same way that you would be touched by someone's hand, it's something that you remember. It leaves a mark upon you. And later on, when you least expect it, in some midnight hour of the soul or in some elated moment of skipping down the street, this tune rushes into your mind, or some note of courage or sustaining power comes into your heart, and this comes from the music, and you are in the presence of that music again, miraculously. So it is this civilizing and sustaining force that sticks with you for your life, and this is why it's important, as all the arts are important in this way.
What brought you to conducting?
I was playing the piano, and pianists have to play lots and lots of notes, and once I realized I could take care of all the notes I was playing, I thought, well, as an extra challenge, I could give some advice to this guy who's playing violin in the in this piano quartet with me, and so it kind of grows out of the chamber music experience to then being able to imagine a larger ensemble.
And is there something other than musicality, if that's the right word, understanding music, that makes a great conductor? Obviously, like a great coach, what makes a great conductor in part is a great orchestra.
Absolutely. It's a collaborative process, and it's a unique chemistry, and there can be very, very great conductors and very great orchestras who cannot work with one another because they are just coming at it from a different perspective, and they have to find just the right mate.
So you could find somebody that's brilliant with the Chicago Symphony as a conductor, is brilliant, who could come to New York with the Philharmonic and not be as good.
It's absolutely possible, and of course,
because the chemistry, the whole thing.
And as you consider multinational aspects of music making, it's very possible, for example, that someone could be a huge hit with the Concertgebouw and not with the Chicago Symphony, or a major success with the Orchestre de la France and not with the New York Philharmonic, and so on. And it's just, it's a different chemistry, it's a different approach, because a great deal of trust is necessary on the part of the musicians and the conductor to respect one another enough to recognize what they each have to contribute to the performance.
Do you have a role model?
Oh gosh, you know, many. I mean, there are musicians I've seen work, of course, Bernstein, certain aspects of Boulez, and aspects of conductors I never saw, like Koussevitzky and Stokowski, I did see. Metropolis, people who were courageous. I think that all of us owe a very special debt to any of the artists, whether they were conductors or performers of the past, who were courageous enough to expand the repertoire by encouraging composers to write big pieces and then putting in the time to make these pieces go over the footlights. So a violinist, for example, like Louis Krasner, a very great American violinist who recently passed away, who had the courage to commission Alban Berg to write this fiddle concerto. Berg didn't want to write it, but Krasner convinced him that he could write this great concerto, and Krasner premiered this piece with the Vienna Philharmonic in a very hostile, anti-Semitic Vienna at that time, and made the piece work and championed it, and it's become, of course, Berg's most celebrated piece.
Mm-hmm. Conducting, what do you have to learn? What did you have to learn to be good?
You have to learn all the notes of the piece, which means sitting there at the piano and playing them all.
Right.
You have to learn to prioritize the different roles of the notes, and you have to get a kind of take on it all. Maybe because I come from a theatrical family, it's very important to me the subtext of it all. You know, what does this mean? Or classically, like one of the questions that Bernstein would have asked me, so you come to a place in the score and it says, poco rallentando, go a little slower. Yeah. But then you have to ask yourself the question, why does the composer want us to go a little slower? Do we go slower here because the harmonies are so beautiful that we want it to last forever? Or because we sense something ahead that's so frightening that we don't want to get there, we're holding back? Or because we've sort of lost our way and not quite sure which way to turn? All those things are motivationally quite different and can be reflected differently in the way we get slower. So I think that's very, very important. And finally, the ability to listen, the ability to do what you need to do to cue and keep the ensemble together and be aware of what's happened, what is happening now, and what needs to happen in the future by really being able to listen.
You were at the Buffalo Symphony Orchestra. You were at the London Symphony, mm-hmm. Which you left recently. Mm-hmm. But for a long time, people have asked, when and where will Michael Tilson Thomas land? Was there a reason it only happened at 50?
Well, I had various offers to do projects in a lot of places, and I think I was and am a very project-oriented person. So for many years, I was working on things like the Charles Ives Critical Edition and a lot of projects with the Gershwin family and completing a lot of Copland's work recording-wise. Made pioneering recordings of Beethoven symphonies with chamber orchestra and the sort of metronome markings, which just now are front page news. And I had many projects like this, which I pursued, and I pursued them internationally. But 8 years or so ago, I became principal conductor of the London Symphony Orchestra, which was a very great experience because it was an orchestra that was self-governing and still is self-governing. So it put me in direct contact with the musicians themselves, rather than going through committees or structures of management,
and boards and all
it was right with them. And I think this was the building, most important foundation to my realizing I could come back to the United States and have the confidence to speak as a human being and as a fellow musician to whoever I needed to within the orchestra.
The building experience there with the London. Did you follow Previn?
I followed Claudio Abbado.
Ah, who followed Previn.
Correct.
Right. And where he's now where? Claudio Abbado.
He's with the Berlin Philharmonic.
The Berlin Philharmonic, right.
Another self-governing orchestra.
Yeah. And he, did he succeed von Karajan?
Correct. And I just say this because, you see, over the years in San Francisco, I had done so much guest conducting.
Yeah.
In fact, I had done just about 100 performances with the orchestra at the time that I was named music director. So there was this building over many, many years of a level of trust between me and the musicians and the kind of daring things that I was asking them to do. Because my style of work is to rehearse very hard, but to create a kind of free and spontaneous space in which the music can take place. I'm not a kind of conductor who wants to go beat, 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 follow me, here it is. But I want to say, yes, these two beats I have to give. Follow me here, bang, bang. But now, this dear first oboist, this dear viola section, that this is for you. Do something interesting. And now here I will take it back from you and give it to someone else. Because I like this feeling of many personalities, when you have great soloists, as we do in the great American orchestras, that to give them the space to let their personalities be part of the music making is something I think is vitally important.
This is Michael Tilson Thomas, San Francisco Symphony, Prokofiev, Romeo and Juliet, the latest thing you've done.
Yes.
And this book, what is this?
This is a book of conversations and reflections that I did with Edward Seckerson. He asked me some questions, and I waxed, I hope, eloquently about these things.
About music.
It's about music. And there's been a very interesting reaction to this book, because there have been two main reactions. One has been, gosh, what a relief, a book by a conductor which didn't have all of those stupid backstage gossip stories, but really was about music. And the other reaction was, oh, how disappointing, a book without, by a conductor without all those horrible backstage...
Oh, my God, I should have asked you for some gossip, shouldn't I?
My next book will have to have the gossip.
We'll have gossip, all right. It's great to have you on this broadcast. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very
much. Pleasure. Very much, David. I look forward to hearing the San Francisco.
Well, and here's the Prokofiev. This is a good one. I don't say that easily about work I do, but this is one of the proudest achievements of my life is this disc.
Great. Remember that. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you tomorrow night. See you then.
By a grant from USA Networks as part of our continuing commitment to innovative television. Through USA Network and the Sci-Fi Channel, we provide original entertainment to America and the world. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders. To order Charlie Rose program transcripts for $5 each and video cassettes for $29.95 each, call 1-800 All News, or write to Journal Graphics at the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.